Philippine House lawmaker Arnulfo Teves Jr. and six others charged over weapons seized from the congressman's properties. An employers group warns the proposed 750 peso minimum wage hike could force small businesses to shut down. We'll get the side of one of the authors of the proposed measure, Gabriela Party List Representative Arlene Brosas, later on in the program. The Philippines records over 1,400 new HIV cases in the month of January. And press freedom stalwart Luis Teodoro passes away. We'll talk about his legacy with UP Diliman Associate Professor of Journalism Danilo Aro. Hi, I'm Camilla Constantino. Dateline Philippines begins right now. Thanks for joining us. For those of you watching us on YouTube and on Facebook, nice to have you with us today. Topping the midday news, police have filed criminal complaints against Congressman Arnulfo Teves Jr. and six others over weapons seized from his properties. Our very own Rafi Santos now joins us with details. Rafi, what more can you tell us?
Yes, Carmina, earlier today, the Criminal Investigation and Detection Group of Philippine National Police has confirmed that it is indeed filed cases against Representative Arnulfo Teves and six others in connection with weapons and explosives found in separate raids into his properties on last March 10, 2023. According to the CIDG, Teves has been charged with the violations of RA 10591, or the Comprehensive Firearms and Ammunition Regulation Act, and RA 9516, the Law on Explosives. Cases were also filed against Jose Pablo Guimarangan, Roland Pablio, and a secretary of Arnulfo Teves, Hannah May, Heracleo Sangasin Oray, and Rodolfo Teves Maturan, and Joseph Kyle Maturan were also charged with these same cases. According to the CIDG, six of these respondents have been brought to Metro Manila and have been inquested as part of the filing of the cases. Now, according to the CIDG, they are still awaiting what the prosecutors will do with these complaints, if they will file the necessary cases against these respondents. Right now, we are still trying to get a statement from the representative or the lawyer of Congressman Arnulfo Teves with regards to these charges. Carmina.
All right, Rafi, just a quick question. The six others, what's their involvement here? What's their connection with those weapons seized in the congressman's properties?
Okay. Carmina, there were separate raids in different places in Negros Oriental on March 10, 2023. These were executed by the PNP CIDG, including the CIDG National Capital Region Field Unit. And according to the head of the National Capital Region Field Unit, Colonel Hansel Marantan, these people were inside the properties when they were the firearms were seized. Some of them, including one allegedly, is a secretary of the Congressman Arnulfo Teves, and the other one is reportedly a gunman connected to Teves. Details are murky as of the moment. Carmina, we have yet to see the filed papers with the prosecutor's office. The CIDG has promised to furnish us with copies of the said documents within today. And as soon as we get them, we will get back to you with more details. Carmina.
Finally, Rafi, what other info are your sources telling you? Are your sources telling you that this is just the beginning, that there will be more cases filed against the congressman?
Okay. According to the CIDG statement today, just one complaint was filed against Congressman Teves, but they are readying other charges against him. According to the CIDG, when we ask for clarification, this is because some of the firearms seized in a different raid were formerly registered to Congressman Teves. That is why he was implicated in that charge. Mm. In the other raids, in the other confiscations of explosives and firearms, they have yet to ascertain if Congressman Teves owned those firearms as well, but they were seized in his properties. So that is why in the statement that the CIDG gave us today, it said that unfortunately Congressman Teves and Kurt Matthew Teves were not around during the implementation of the search warrant, but right now the CIDG is working to file cases against these people as soon as possible. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Rafi Santos there joining us on the line. Back here in the newsroom, for Philippine Senator J.V. Ejercito, Congressman Teves remaining in the U.S. is not helping him clear his name. Ejercito believes Teves' absence only breeds more speculation on his alleged links to the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Roel Degamo.
Well, I'm hoping that he comes home as soon as possible and face the music. If he is indeed not guilty, then there is nothing that he should be worried about. And because of him being in the United States, a lot of people are speculating that, you know, there's a saying that flight means guilt, or just before the fatal ambush of Governor DeGamo, it was a coincidence that he was there in the U.S. So he has to come home and face all the cases that are being filed against him.
As the chairperson of the Senate Committee on Local Government, Ejercito says he's personally disappointed over the supposed security lapses during DeGamo's murder.
With these political killings, I think this is a black eye on the country's image. So the Philippine National Police, the AFP, all the law enforcement agencies really has to step up. Again, controversial nga yung naging intelligence fund during the budget deliberations. I'm hoping that they put this into good use. Gamitin nila ito. Nasaan napunta yun? Pinaglaban namin yan para magamit nyo. And I'm very, very disappointed that there was failure of intelligence in Negros Oriental.
Meanwhile, the new governor of Negros Oriental, Carlo Reyes, officially took over from his slain predecessor, Ruel DeGamo. Annie Paris now joins us with that story. Annie, over to you.
Yes, Fermina, the new governor of Negros Oriental was emotional when he took his seat inside the office at the provincial capital of Negros Oriental. He was still in disbelief at what happened to his predecessor, Governor Carlo George John Gido Reyes, even hugged tight the standee of the slain Governor Ruel DeGamo. He said that he hopes the death of DeGamo will be the start of peace in Negros Oriental. It took some time for Reyes to come to the office and visit the office of DeGamo because he is currently recovering from an illness and was even on medical leave when DeGamo was slain last March 4th. He arrived yesterday afternoon on a wheelchair with his aides assisting him. He told the employees of the Capitol that they should not be sad and they should be strong, and that he also explained that there are no replacements yet except for the position of provincial administrator, where he faced attorney Khan Lizette Molas, and also he changed the provincial legal officer who is now attorney Mary Grace Villegas. Apart from these changes, Carmina, no other orders were made by the new governor, but he also mentioned that he will attend the burial of Governor DeGamo at his hometown in Chaton this Thursday. Reyes succeeded DeGamo after the incident last March 4 at the residence of the governor in Barangay San Isidro in Pamplona town. And the following day, he was sworn into office by Interior Secretary Benhur Abalos in the medical facility in Manila. Reyes also added that he will work as much as DeGamo in his capacity, and the person who replaced him, and he ensured a smooth transition in his previous position as vice governor with first board member Manuel Chaco Sagarbarria Jr. And that's the latest here in Central Visayas. Annie Perez, ABS-CBN News.
Here in the newsroom, China's warning over the expanded defense cooperation deal between the Philippines and the U.S. drawing mixed reactions. Senator Francis Escudero slams the Chinese government for interfering, saying the Philippines has the right to pursue a foreign policy that serves its interest. Senator Jingoy Estrada, meanwhile, says pursuing renewed ties with the U.S. does not mean the country is waging a war against China. But Senator Amy Marcos is concerned the Philippines may get dragged into a conflict involving Taiwan. For Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, there's a need to further study the mutual defense treaty between Manila and Washington. For an analyst, despite all of China's rhetoric, it's not keen on waging a war against the U.S.
Kung titingnan natin yung behaviors ni China, kumbaga talagang nananakot lang talaga sila. Kasi parang alam mo yung behavior ng mga bully, pananakot lang yung ginagawa nila. Aksidente na lang kung may miscalculation. Yun yung pinaghahandaan natin, yung miscalculation. But as of now, iniiwasan din ni China at ni US na magkaroon ng digmaan. Kasi yung ekonomiya nila na medyo struggling right now, Yun yung pinapahalagaan natin. Ating kailangan gawin is maging clever tayo sa ating diplomasya with China, no? Mm-hmm. More engagements, more negotiations to them.
Meanwhile, the leaders of the U.S., U.K., and Australia unveil a submarine deal in a move seen to counter China's ambitions in the Indo-Pacific. The deal is part of the so-called AUKUS project, first announced in 2021. Under that agreement, America will sell to Australia three nuclear-powered subs with an option to buy two more. A joint statement from the leaders also said the multi-stage project could or would culminate in the production of a new class of submarine, which will be based on Britain's design, built in the UK and Australia, and include cutting-edge US technologies.
So today, as we stand at the inflection point in history, where the hard work of enhancing deterrence and promoting stability is going to affect the prospect of peace for decades to come, the United States can ask for no better partners in the Indo-Pacific, where so much of our shared future will be written.
We are bound above all by our belief in a world where the sovereignty of every nation is respected and the inherent dignity of every individual is upheld, where peace, stability, and security ensure greater prosperity and a greater measure of fairness for all, and where all countries are able to act in their sovereign interests, free from coercion.
Back here at home, the Employers Confederation of the Philippines, or ECOP, warns small businesses could close if the proposed 750 peso wage hike is implemented. The proposed measure was filed by the Macabayan Bloc at the House of Representatives. ECOP says wage hikes do not even cover workers of the informal sector who will bear the brunt of the consequences.
This should be majority, 84%. This should be the farm workers, the market drivers, duty drivers, merchant vendors, small businesses they're not covered by this, no? So if you increase the salary to whatever, the price of the will increase. We're trying to avoid inflation. But to increase salaries like that would probably, would, my goodness, is that if it is implemented, 12.5% inflation will be something that you probably have to contend with.
Joining us now, one of the authors of this new wage hike bill, Gabriela Party List Representative Arlene Brosas. Representative Brosas, good afternoon to you. Thank you for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Hello, good afternoon. Magandang
hapon
tanghali.
Hapon.
Magandang tanghali, Carmina. Thank you.
Okay, so we heard what Sergio Ortiz Luis Junior said there. We're going to get to that in a bit. But first, I'm going to cut to the chase here, because one of the criticisms is that it will quicken inflation, this proposal of yours to hike the minimum wage to 750 pesos. Why won't this be inflationary?
First of all, sinasabi natin, kina-counter-argument po natin yan. Wage hikes are not essentially inflationary, ano? Mas ang mga issues po natin dito ay ang monopoly pricing, reliances on imports, regressive taxation. Mas yun po, ano, yung culprit ng mga high prices sa ngayon. Kasi nag 8.6 inflation tayo ngayon, eh, no? Now, as to the sinasabi ng mga economists or sinasabi ng mga kontra sa dagdag sahod natin na inflationary ito, pero sa amin, para sa amin, may strong economic multiplier effect po ang pagtaas ng sahod. Kung bakit namin ito nasabi, halimbawa, no, pag in-increase natin yung wage, ibig sabihin, yung mga low-income wage workers natin, mag-spend sila. Kasi nag-spend sila buo naman, eh, di ba? Yung buong sahod nila, spend nila yun ng mga pangangailangan nila. So, ibig sabihin, hindi sila nagtitira. Hindi nga sila, wala nga silang savings, eh, di ba? So, for consumption talaga. As, tapos, kung nag-spend sila, locally sila nag-spend on micro, small, and medium enterprises din naman, di ba? Including yung mga informal enterprises sa mga komunidad. So nag-spur siya ng local economic activity, which helps basically ang small businesses natin na mag-induce ng job generation din. Third, sabi natin, yung mga low-income families, they spend more on food, right? Pagkain. 48% ng income nila napupunta sa pagkain. Meaning, pag nag-increase ka ng spending sa food, mag-stimulate siya ng demand for economic activity sa countryside, sa kanayunan. Agriculture po yan. So yun po yung sinasabi natin na meron siyang strong economic multiplier effect. Ngayon, ang problema, ayaw ng mga big businesses, of course, na magtaas ng sahod. Ano? Yan po yung sinasabi ng mga big corporations, even ECOP. No? Kanina nga narinig ko po yun. Ang sagot natin dyan, they can, and they can't speak for small corporations. Dapat po, ang magsalita sa mga micro and small enterprises natin ay yung mga maliliit nating enterprises. And we have reasons, no, na nilagay natin dito sa panukala mismo na tulungan yung mga small and medium enterprises through wage subsidies.
We're gonna go to that in a bit. But first, Sari Ortiz-Suiz there made a point na yung makikinabang naman dito sa wage hike ay hindi yung mga nasa informal sector, which comprises majority of the labor force. Hindi naman daw silang makikinabang eh. So parang hindi rin makakatulong sa mas nakararami yung pinapanukala ninyong batas. Anong sagot niyo doon? Go ahead.
Hindi po totoo yan. Kasi halimbawa, 48% ang makikinabang lalo na sa formal sector dahil yung medium and big corporations, nandoon po yung mga manggagawa natin eh. And alam nyo po, any amount ng increase ng wage para sa kanila ay malaking tulong. Lalo na sa nagtataas ang presyo, high prices natin ngayon. Diba? So, ang sinasabi po natin dito, in fact, kaya pura tayo merong wage subsidy para tulungan din yung mga sections na kailangan ng tulong. At may appropriations po na nararapat dyan ng gobyerno. Yun po yung ginawa natin. Ngayon, hindi excuse yung hindi maibigay yung nang sapat yung o nang ang makatwiran na sahod para sa mga manggagawa natin, lalo na ng mga medium and big corporations. When in fact, data says na ang mga big and medium corporations ay kumita kahit po nung panahon ng pandemya, meron pa nga nagtriple ang profits. So ibig sabihin, they can, ayaw nilang ibigay, they can give it, no?
Which brings us to my next question, Congresswoman Brosas. The fact that you're asking for it now doesn't mean that it was only needed now, right? There's been increased productivity in the past years, but the wages remained stagnant. So even if you were making your calls back then and they were ignored, what makes you think that this time around the powers that be will listen?
Well, precisely that's the point, no? Kasi sabi nga natin, totoo yan, ano, Carmina? Talagang nung mga nirali na natin, ginawa na natin ang paraan, there are barriers talaga. For example, sa 17 regions, wala naman significant na pagtaas ng sahod na nangyari. Ang last pa natin na medyo malaki-laki, what is that? 25 or 50 pesos? Panahon ni Cory Aquino. When it was regional wage boards na ang nangyari, nag-tripartite na, wala na talagang naging significant na increase para sa wages. Pero yung inflation, tuloy-tuloy. Yung high prices, tuloy-tuloy. So, hindi talaga nagkaroon ano, ng reprieve yung mga manggagawa. What makes us so sure ngayon na ano na tutugunan nito, of course, it's in the people's will pa rin, di ba? Sabi nga natin, dapat hindi lang yung powers that be, dapat yung mga tao manawagan talaga, no? Lalong-lalo na. At ito naman ang kahilingan sa ng mga labor workers natin, labor leaders natin. This is in consultation with our labor workers and labor leaders. Ang sabi po nila sa BMP, sa KMU, sa lahat po, no, kilusan ng manggagawang kababaihan, lahat po, no, ay nagsasabi na kailangan nila ng taas sahod. So,
but here you are, Congresswoman Brosas, That's the situation now, right? You feel that that's the need that needs to be addressed. But here you are, you're there at the House of Representatives, and your colleagues are doing something else. Ang pinagtutuunan po nila ng pansin, MIF, charter change. Ang sabi po nila, ito ang magbibigay ng ganansya sa ating bayan. Na yun ang kanilang pagtutuunan ng pansin at hindi itong mas current at mas needed at mas urgent na concern. Ano po ang sinasabi nin ng ganung sitwasyon or ng ganung klaseng pag-focus no sa ganung klaseng mga issue? Anong sinasabi noon sa inyo tungkol mismo sa inyong mga kasamahan diyan sa Kongreso?
Yes, the more dapat na we should advocate for the increase ng wages. Ano? Kasi may kinalaman din po ito sa usapin ng charter change. Kung ito nga po ay hindi maasikaso ng administrasyon ngayon, di ibig sabihin, paano tayo maniniwala na buong-buong mag-change ka ng constitution? For whom? For what? Diba? Kaya kailangan po ito eh. Magbabago ka kaagad ng mga fundamentals ng 60-40, ng pagpasok ng mga foreign corporations dito, pero ito hindi mo maibigay para sa ating mga simpleng mamamayan o ordinaryong mga manggagawa. So, napaka-ironic, no? When we're talking about how much na millions nagagastusin para sa billion nagagastusin para sa charter change, and here we are, kailangan natin magtaas ng sahod sa mga ano, hindi na lang dito i-direct, no? Kasi ito naman ay immediate at kailangan talaga. As to the mga colleagues natin na ano, actually we are asking the leadership, kasi meron namang deliberation by tomorrow on wages. So we are hoping na ito ay maisama, no? So we will fight para ito ay mapag-usapan, ano, bukod sa national minimum wage na issue at sa usapin ng 750 across the board nationwide na increase ng wage.
Kasi halimbawa, Congresswoman, ano na lang kaya ang mangyayari kung halimbawa hindi ito maplansya ngayon at dumating na nga itong mga ganansyang sinasabi nila sa pagpasok ng mga bagong magpupuhunan, no, mamumuhunan sa ating bansa, pero nakapako ang sweldo sa ganito kababa. Ano sa tingin niyo ang mangyayari doon?
Eh di syempre hindi rin gagananan yung ating mga mamamayan. Lalong-lalo na yung mga workers natin. This is unfair to them, ano. It is a big injustice kung ganun yung mangyayari, no. Kasi actually ito kayang-kayang tugunan, no, ng administrasyon ngayon. Kayang-kaya, kung merong political will ang administration to increase the wages, kaya niya yon eh. Pwede niya talagang gawin yon. So we are hoping na ito ay ma-table talaga. Yan.
Okay, finally, to the point that you were making a while ago, that they're increasing the minimum wage or the would have a multiplier effect. But will it kill the small, medium-scale enterprises? Kasi yun din po ang sinasabi. Sige, taasan nyo. Pero ang kapalit niyan, mamamatay naman yung mga maliliit na negosyante.
Yun, sinasabi po natin kanina, no, back to that, no. Pwede talagang i-appropriate, ano, kasi meron naman talagang pwedeng wage subsidies para hindi maghirap yung mga corporations, makasurvive yung mga maliliit, no, na small and medium enterprises natin. Actually, may pagkukunan ka dyan sa wealth tax pa lang, pwede na eh, diba? At saka sa unprogrammed funds, diba? Marami naman at malaking unprogrammed funds natin. Tapos, nagsasabi tayo ng yung fiscal space natin ay ganito. Eh di pwede naman 'yon, ano, magamit yung mga tira, no, mga ano natin, mga save natin, no, na funds sa gobyerno para magamit ito at mabigay as wage subsidy sa ating mga small and medium corporations, small and medium enterprises. Mm-hmm. So, 'yan pwedeng may sagot din tayo na ganyan, ano, at kayang gawin yon. Kaya hindi reason ang hindi pagtaas ng sahod ng ating mga manggagawa.
All right, Congresswoman Arlene Brosses there of Park Gabriela, Party List Representative. Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Maraming salamat po.
Thank you. Maraming salamat, Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Take care. We're going to take a quick break now. Up ahead, the Philippine Senate begins its probe into the massive oil spill in Oriental Mindoro. We'll give you details of that story and more in Dateline Philippines Returns. Stay with ANC. you're still watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC, the Public Works Department has announced a bridge project that will connect Cavite and Bataan. Katrina Domingo now joins us with details. Kat, over to you.
Hi, Carmina. The construction of the 175 billion peso bridge that will connect Bataan and Cavite has been accelerated by the latter part of this year. That's according to DPWH Secretary Manuel Bonoan. If we recall, that project was slated to start construction by next year in 2024. But Bonoan says it's now ready to begin by the end of 2023, particularly because the government is almost done with its design engineering, which is already at 70%. That means that the only thing that's left for the government to do is to procure civil works materials needed to construct this bridge that is expected to cut travel time between Manila and Bataan to 2 hours from the original five-hour trip. Bonoan says that it has been the priority of the DPWH to construct this bridge, particularly because the growth corridors are in the southern part of Metro Manila as well as the northern part of Metro Manila. He says this project will give the capital city or the capital region have better access to these emerging growth areas. He says no less than the Asian Development Bank has indicated that the economic return of this bridge will be more than 25% of the project cost. Now, the 32-kilometer bridge is expected to be completed in 5 years. That's as the DPWH pushes to complete several high-ticket or big-ticket projects before the term of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. ends. This bridge is part of some 70,000 major and minor infrastructure projects, both in the national and local level, that the DPWH is planning to begin by this year. Carmina.
Thanks a lot. Katrina Domingo there joining us live. Thanks, Kat. Back here in the newsroom, the Philippines has recorded over 1,400 new HIV cases in January. The health department said of the total reported cases, 79 were aged 10 to 19 years old and 7 were less than 10 years old. All except one of the reported adolescent cases acquired HIV through sexual contact. 95% of all cases recorded in January were male. For an infectious diseases specialist, this data is not surprising.
Really more of the behavior among this age group. Na siguro nakikita namin dito, mga parents nito are not aware of the activities of these children or this adolescent. And at times, they're also influenced by their mga peer groups, okay? And I think that's something that's alarming because with that age group, they're highly vulnerable. Very difficult to control HIV in the Philippines unless we have to do very important and drastic measures at the level of the community on how we can engage this mga high-risk group. For me, it's really education on proper sexual behavior, on how to protect themselves.
Veteran journalist Luis Teodoro has passed away. He was 81 years old. The UP College of Mass Communication announced the news on social media. It said Teodoro, who served as dean from 1994 to 2000, was pivotal in fostering academic excellence, upholding integrity in the practice of media, and defending the freedoms of the press, speech, and assembly. Teodoro was the founding chairperson of Alter Media, a network of media outfits, institutions, and individuals. He was also known for his political commentaries. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines mourns the death of an icon of Philippine journalism. The group remembers Teodoro as the staunchest advocate for the best in the profession and the most savage critic of its worst practices. It also vows to continue Teodoro's legacy of wielding the pen in the service of the people. Carlos Conde of Human Rights Watch, meanwhile, says the Philippine media landscape won't be the same without Teodoro. Joining us now to talk about the legacy of Luis Teodoro is Danilo Arao. He is Associate Professor of Journalism in UP Diliman and Associate Editor of Bulatlat. Dan, good afternoon to you. Thank you for joining us today and welcome to the program.
Yeah, good afternoon, Carmina, and thank you for the invitation once again.
Well, first of all, Professor, my deepest condolences. I know that he was a mentor. He was a, you know, when you think about Dean, you really think that he was, and you feel it, that he was a soldier of truth. and a pillar of Philippine journalism here. What tell us about the void that he leaves behind?
Definitely, the void can be described as something that is missing in journalism right now, and that is responsible journalism and truth-telling and, you know, the basic principles of journalism, which includes stewardship. Pardon my incoherence right now because my mind is somewhere else. But at any rate, the kind of legacy that he has left behind pressures all of us to make sure that his teachings will live on, and that his books, his and all of his numerous articles, particularly his column articles, published publicly, would be accessible to people, and that we will take to heart the lessons, not just of responsible citizenship, but of the importance of social change and being a voice for the voiceless, which is what journalism is all about.
Oh, Professor, you mentioned the word stewardship just a while ago. And when you think about Dean, you think about what he really was, and that's what he was. He was a steward. Tell us about the passion, why he was unrelenting in educating and guiding future and current journalists of the country.
Okay, just to give you some trivia, even at his age of about 81, going 82, he's still teaching, albeit as a lecturer here at the College of Mass Communication. He's handling, I think, one course because the need to teach is still there. It's not for the money. It is for his passion to be in touch with the students, to ensure that he will continue to shape young minds. And for former students like me, we can only hope that we can equal. We can definitely not surpass him, but we hope that we can just achieve half of what he has achieved, and things will be fine for Philippine journalism. You know, Carmina, the problem with Philippine journalism right now is that it's not just wrapped by disinformation. There's also the problem of ownership interest and advertising interest and other unethical practices. And these are the things that Chudoro talks about, not just in the classroom, but also in his books and numerous column articles. So we hope that with his passing, his legacy will live on, and that we will continue his tradition of responsible journalism and, you know, being biased for the truth and being a voice for the voiceless. Mm. So these are the values that he repeatedly says and stresses in his classes.
Tell us about your personal dealings with him. Tell us about how he was your mentor, but he was also your colleague. Tell us about the partnership that was formed through the years. Go ahead.
Well, he was my teacher way back in the 1980s when I was still a student at UP Diliman. This is my office, by the way. I've known him when he was still my teacher. And I do remember, even while he was aware that I was section editor of the Philippine Collegian, sometimes during class, he would, you know, put out the latest issue of the Collegian, and he would say, look at this new section. These are terrible articles. And it just so happens that I was the one who edited those articles. And sometimes I'm the one who wrote those articles. I mean, I didn't take it. Of course, at that time, I was hurt. But later on, I noticed the importance of, you know, subjecting to a workshop such journalistic outputs. And these are the things that I still do up to now. And just to be fair to Professor Chudoro, he does so not to embarrass you in front of your classmates, but to teach you an important lesson that journalism should be taken seriously and that you should strive more to excel because your responsibility is not for fame, for fortune, or for clout chasing, but to help in the shaping of public opinion. And that's what Chudoro is all about. And on a personal note, we've become friends through the years, despite our age difference. We're friends in the sense that my first car, a Suzuki Vitara, came from him. My digital camera came from him. He was a principal sponsor to my wedding. And in the milestones of my daughter, he was there to guide my daughter through. And even during the first birthday of my daughter, who's now studying at UPIS, she was there. He was there. Again, pardon my incoherence, but that's the problem with trying to recall those things, because it hurts on one hand on a personal level, but on the other hand, I am happy that future journalism students will be in good hands, because he has left a legacy of several books and several column articles that we can look back on and make sure that we will draw lessons from what he has meant. So to Professor Chodoro, even if, if you're listening right now, we will soldier on, and we will definitely fight for the truth and fight for a better society, which is what your message is all about.
It's all right. It's all right. I completely understand. Because you were one of the few lucky ones, Professor, who was able to share that space, maybe for an hour and a half, a couple of times each week, engaging in discourses, maybe listening, maybe reasoning out as well when the professor was in class. But tell us, why is it that for every student who left that classroom, taught by Dean Teodoro, why is it that their lives are forever changed?
He makes an impact. I mean, not to be too personal about Professor Teodoro, he speaks in such a very, very low voice, and sometimes you cannot even hear what he's trying to say. I'm not sure if he's doing that on purpose, but even if he speaks in such a slow voice and, a very low-pitched voice, he is able to provide the necessary message. Why? Because the truth is on his side. He prepares hard for class, he knows current events, he knows what he is talking about. So you cannot really, tell him that what he's saying is wrong, for the simple reason that he has done his homework. And that is one of the values of education that he imparts on young people like on the young people and the older people like me, for example, because you have to take your work seriously. And that's the thing about Teodoro. We remember him more as a journalist, but in fact, as a teacher, he has excelled by leaps and bounds. And that's why I don't want to bring this up, because we're talking about his passing. Sometimes it makes me wonder why he was not selected as a professor emeritus in the university, when in fact he deserves it. And just because he doesn't have a master's degree or a doctoral degree, I mean, it doesn't mean anything compared to, the kind of status that he has. He should have that kind of recognition by everyone. But then again, an emeritus title is one honor, but the bigger honor of all is that he is the dean. And he remains as dean, even if his term has already expired here in the College of Mass Communication, and he is forever remembered by the journalism community. So again, I condole with the family of Teodoro, but rest assured that his legacy will live on. And Carmina, please bear with me. I take this opportunity to also publicly apologize to the family, because I posted prematurely the announcement regarding Professor Teodoro this morning, when in fact it was not cleared with them, so it came out as insensitive and unauthorized, and I do apologize for that. So to Civil, to Ato, and to Irene, the sister of Professor Teodoro, and Dr. Noel Teodoro as well, my apologies for the lapse in judgment this morning.
I'm sure the apology will be well taken. In the meantime, we'd like to thank you, Professor Danilo Aro, there. Again, our condolences to the entire UP community, to the entire journalism profession. But as you said a while ago, even if he didn't get recognized the way he should be recognized, I guess the bigger honor is that he lives on in every single work that we put out there, because we will make sure that his legacy is kept alive. Thank you so much for joining us.
Well said, Carmina. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And from there, we're going to take a quick break. Still ahead, the Philippines' trade deficit widens further in January. More on that when we come back. You're watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. back. You're still watching Dateline Philippines here on ANC. The sunken tanker that caused the massive oil spill in Oriental Mindoro had no permit to operate. This was confirmed by the Maritime Industry Authority in an ongoing Senate hearing. The owner of the ship told senators they were helping with a cleanup, but affected local government units say the company has not laid down its plans to help them cope with the damage caused by the oil spill. Aside from livelihood, Senator Cynthia Villar says the oil spill is a setback to efforts to strengthen the country's ecosystem.
Based on reports, the oil spill threatens around 21 locally managed marine protected area, including the Verde Island Passage, which is the center of the global shore fish biodiversity. And this happened while there are pending bills poised to give Verde Island as a legislated protected area.
According to the Office of Civil Defense, a total of 108,000 people in Palawan and Oriental Mindoro have been affected by the oil spill. Some 122 individuals have also gotten sick.
Today, about 4,125 liters of oily water mixtures and 12,685 liters of waste have been collected from the cleanup operations. Due to the effects of the oil spill, 9 cities or municipalities in Oriental Mindoro have declared a state of calamity.
I'm here to find out if our laws are sufficient to hold people responsible for the oil spill liable for what has happened. Can they be held civilly or criminally liable? The problem of the oil spill means so much more to our country than any other country. Kasi nga po, tayo ay isang archipelago.
A Philippine lawmaker says the owner of the sunken tanker that caused the spill in Oriental Mindoro is liable under several international conventions, citing the 1992 International Convention on Civil Liability for Oil Pollution Damage. Aklan Representative Teodorico Jaresco says RDC Rail Marine Services should pay some 330 million pesos in damages. He says beyond cleanups, the owner of the tanker should be held accountable for damaging tourism sites and marine resources. An environmental law expert also urges government to demand payment over the oil spill.
Palagi tayong nagkukulang sa demanda. Dapat kasi papabayarin natin sa hindi lang ng clean up, kung yung damage, di ba? Yung loss, yung long-term damage, yun ang palagi natin hindi nagagawa. Hindi pa appropriate yung ano din kasi gusto mo rin malaman yung extent ng damage, di ba? Lagi nga sinasabi nila na parang yung hindi pa ito yung oil mismo na transported oil na tinatransport. Parang ito pa lang yung oil na ginagamit ng barko, di ba? Kailangan mo i-distinguish yun kasi kung yung cargo na yun lalabas na, nako, mas grabing pinsala, di ba?
Kaya nga.
We really have to wait until clear ang damage.
World News Now, the International Criminal Court will reportedly open two cases against Russian officials over the invasion of Ukraine. According to the New York Times, the first case involves Russia's alleged abduction of Ukrainian children who were supposedly sent for adoption or to re-education camps. The second alleges Russian forces deliberately targeted key civilian infrastructure with missile attacks. The report comes following the visit of ICC prosecutor Karim Khan to the war-torn country earlier this month. Iran pardons over 22,000 people who took part in recent anti-government protests. They were part of the over 82,000 people granted amnesty by Iran's supreme leader early last month. This gives a glimpse of the scope of Iran's crackdown on dissent after mass protests erupted last year, triggered by the death of Mahsa Amini in custody of the so-called morality police. The protests mark one of the boldest challenges to the Islamic Republic since the 1979 revolution. China will resume issuing all visa types to foreigners for the first time since 2020. Starting Wednesday, all categories of visas will be available, and areas that required no visas during pre-pandemic times will revert to visa-free entry. The move comes after authorities last month declared victory over a recent surge in COVID cases. The looser border control is expected to rekindle a $17 trillion economy that has suffered one of its slowest growth rates in nearly half a century. In business, consumers should manage their electricity consumption as power costs may rise in the summer months. That's according to Energy Secretary Rafael Lotilla. The Energy Department earlier warned the Luzon grid could face 12 yellow alerts between March and November this year due to insufficiency of power reserves. Lotilla says producers may resort to more costly means if demand is not kept in check.
The peak hours are between 11 to 12 in the Meralco franchise area. It's around 11 to 12 in the morning to 2 to 3 in the afternoon, and sometimes 7 to 8 in the evening. Mangyari niyan, kung mataas yung demand, ang the plants that we will have to run are the oil-based power plants. And if you use oil, as you know, the prices are much higher than if we use the other fuels.
The Philippines posts a $5.74 billion trade deficit in January, the biggest in 5 months. It's wider than the December trade deficit of $4.59 billion, which was the narrowest trade shortfall since March 2022. Fueling the growth in the deficit, a 13.5% year-on-year decline in exports and a 3.9% year-on-year increase in imports. Economic officials have been expecting the trade gap to expand alongside increased economic activity as the Philippines remains dependent on imports for many products, including fuel. And that'll do it for today. Thanks for joining us. I'm Carmina Constantino. If you want to revisit today's episode, you can play back this newscast on ANC's YouTube channel and on ANC 24/7 on Facebook. Keep safe. Keep it here on ANC.